The GR9 behind me, as you can see, is a fighter aircraft. It's primarily designed for air-to-surface, and therefore one of our strengths was close air support. It's a single-seat cockpit, and the real virtue of the Harrier is its ability to land and take off vertically, but also conventionally and always in between. So, fabulous office. My name is Paul Tremelling, and I had a career in the Fleet Air Arm flying Sea Harriers, Harriers, and later the Super Hornet with the US Navy. I think the Harrier is a almost perfect amalgam of a warfighting capability, but a real engineering triumph. The ability to take airflow, turn that into thrust, and divert it through the nozzles to give you the vertical landing and takeoff capability is incredible. But having said that, it was a fabulous warfighting capability as well. And part of that capability was the basing options that it would give you. So for example, we could land on ships, we could land on highways, we could land on short strips, we could even land in woodland, etc., in prepared hides. And that made it a really flexible machine, which gave it relevance both in the Cold War, when we were worried about basing options, in the Falklands War, when by sea was the only way to get to the fight, and later in Afghanistan, where we were operating in really thin, high, hot air. The ability for the Harrier to be there was one of its really key attributes.
When runways have been bombed and conventional aircraft either destroyed or grounded, the Harrier can still strike back. The Harrier has been in operational service with the Royal Air Force since early 1969.
So why was it developed? I think the after the Second World War in particular, people were intrigued by VSTOL flight, vertical short takeoff and landing flight, and there were a couple of attempts made. You'll probably have seen the flying bedstead, which was just a way essentially of directing thrust downwards, and then attempts were made to launch aircraft vertically essentially by standing them on their tail. The Harrier was the one that really got to grips with the vectored thrust, the ability to move the thrust from straight aft, where you're flying like any other aeroplane and able to behave like any other aeroplane, to straight down, where you are able to hover on a stack of air, and also everything in between. The nozzles had over 90 degrees worth of travel, and that gave you flexibility in combat, but also many different ways of landing and taking off. The Harrier is controlled like any other aircraft. It's got aerodynamic surfaces which develop lift, and therefore that's how you, if you move the stick, you move the control surface, and the aircraft rolls, goes up, goes down, yaws, etc. But the way things are done in the Harrier, which make it unique, is that out the really high pressure air from the engine is also taken in pipes called reaction control vanes out to the extremities of the aircraft. So in the wingtips, in the nose, and in the tail. And that means that when you start to deploy nozzle, so as in take nozzle from fully aft to fully down, at about the 20 degree point, those start charging up. That means that they're fully charged by the time you get in the hover, and then rather than using airflow over the wings like any other aeroplane does, you're now using jets in the wingtips, the nose and the tail to control the aeroplane. So when I pull back on the stick, the puffer duct in the nose opens, pushes down, the nose comes up, and I drift backwards. The wings are slightly more tricky because there is actually an up and a down. You want all your thrust going down if you can. So to start with, the aircraft just uses a bit of down thrust on one of the wings. If you really need maneuverability and you're moving the stick a long way, it'll open the up one on the other side as well. But so that's how it works in the hover. I started flying the Sea Harrier in about the year 2000. After the end of fast jet training, then went down to Royal Naval Air Station Yeovilton to go to 899 Naval Air Squadron, and that's when we learned to fly in the Harrier, starting with a couple of trips in the twin seater. Then you're thrown into the single seater for your first solo on trip three. Then you had a go twin seat hovering with someone showing you what to do, and then it was straight into hovering on your own thereafter. My first deck landing was done just off Plymouth. There's no way that you can do this in the simulator, or certainly wasn't at the time. So the way that we used to do it on the Sea Harrier Force was, it wasn't actually addressed during the training course. You went to the front line, and then at the first available opportunity, you simply went and landed on an aircraft carrier. I've said it quite often, but the funny thing about landing on ships is they don't seem to get any bigger until you're actually alongside them. You fly towards a small speck in the sea, you marshal above a small speck in the sea, and then you make an approach to a small speck in the sea. And it's only when you're alongside, trying to hover the aircraft at the right height and sort out your forward motion, that you're actually now alongside a big bit of British metal that you're trying to land on. And so it's quite a fraught experience, but a very rewarding one. So the Sea Harrier is a Harrier 1, which meant that we went from the P1127 demonstrator to the Kestrel to the Harrier 1 very, very quickly. And one way that manifested itself is that essentially no thought was given into how it was going to be maintained and how it was going to be fought. The FA2 that I flew was an upgrade of the FRS Mark 1 that flew in the Falklands. It had a far, far better radar, a world-class radar and a world-class weapon, and that made it a great fleet defence fighter that had a multi-role. We could still drop bombs, we could still do a limited reconnaissance task. Going to the new aeroplane, the role sort of reversed in so much as we were now a air-to-surface platform with a limited air-to-air role, so that was something to get your heads around. But the machine itself was fabulous, and it was a Harrier 2. It was not the all-metal Harrier 1. It had a bigger wing, it had a far more forgiving wing that meant that actually flying it was a lot easier. It had a lot more weapon stations, so you could carry more fuel and more weapons, and the cockpit was a ergonomic dream, it really was. Everything was at your fingertips, it had nice big displays, and it was perfectly set up for giving the pilot all the information that he or she needed to do their role, whereas in the earlier aeroplane that was a bit more of an afterthought. All jets are compromises. There isn't a jet on the planet that isn't a compromise, even if that compromise is the financial side of things, the money it took to make it. The Harrier is not going to be able to carry as much and take it as far as land-based air systems, but it doesn't need a long runway to do it. It has flexibility of basing options, and so actually it would still find its way into a force mix of other aircraft. When you look at things like the American aeroplanes, mainly land-based, so for example the F-16, yeah, it's flexible, it can turn really, really tightly. It's a single engine, single seat, very similar to the Harrier in some of the roles it can do, but it's got that lovely air-to-air role that it does very, very well indeed, and the anti-SAM role that it can do. But as a striker, then what did the Harrier give you? It gave you flexibility of weapon load, it gave you quite a large weapon load, so it could still fight its corner, if you like, and would be relevant in most contemporary warfare situations. In about 2006, I went up the road to Cottesmore to start flying the GR7 and GR9. It was a mixed fleet at the time. I had to go via a desk job, so I spent a bit of time at Royal Air Force High Wycombe, but then went up the road to do what was called the conversion course to learn how to fly the new aeroplane. I think that the sensations of flying a fast jet are largely common, as in the speed will be alien when you first strap into one. The thing that will really get you with Harrier flight is that most people are fairly au fait with the thought of thrust being behind you. When you can move your thrust, and it's 21,000 pounds of thrust being vectored by, like I said earlier, up to 90 degrees, that throws you around in the cockpit, and that can at times feel like being in a bit of a tumble dryer, particularly if you overcook it slightly and the jet does actually depart from controlled flight. Then it's a bit of a ride, and you get on with recovering the aeroplane. So largely common sensations with other fast jets, but a few Harrierisms as well. So I deployed to Afghanistan as part of the Joint Force Harrier Detachment. What we did there was essentially keep a three-unit cycle going for 5 years, just over 5 years, I believe. I went there with the Naval Strike Wing in 2008, and as ever, the Joint Force just made things work. It was completely seamless as to whether or not you were a Royal Air Force squadron, a Royal Navy squadron. Our job was simply to help the ground forces, who are the real heroes in this, the people with boots actually on the ground, seeing the things, smelling the things that we didn't have to. The missions would vary, anything from what we called non-traditional intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance, NTISR. That might be sweeping a route for a infantry patrol, for example. It might be taking reconnaissance photographs, or it might be direct close air support. So what we would generally do is some sort of graduation of hostilities, where we would start, if the ground commander asked us to, with what's called a show of force over the top of the enemy position, show we meant business, down at 100 feet at about 490 knots. Give or take, depending on the day. And that could then graduate up into use of lethal force. We used to fly, when I first got there, a mix of CRV-7 rockets and 540-pound weapons on one aircraft, laser-guided bombs on the other. We then got a new laser-guided bomb called the Paveway 4, which was superb. So both jets now flew with two Paveway 4s and two rocket pods, along with all the sensors we needed to on the belly. So this is my logbook, my Royal Naval flying log, and it's a sortie by sortie record of all my flights in all aeroplanes that I flew within the Royal Navy. So if I look here in July 14 of 2009, I flew Zulu Delta 461, which is the aeroplane you see suspended behind me. I was on my own, and my job was to go and do an electronic warfare mission in the Spadeadam ranges, and essentially we go there to exercise against surface-to-air missile systems to see if our countermeasures and our tactics work against them. Can we fly the maneuvers to essentially break locks on those radars and keep ourselves safe? It's odd to see one that you've actually strapped to your back. That's a little bit strange. And it looks like I had an hour and 40 of fun, of which 10 minutes was in cloud, which probably wasn't that much fun. I was away with the French Navy in 2010. I was on their aircraft carrier Charles de Gaulle when I received the news that we were going to go out of service. So there was a significant element of bitterness and sadness, mainly because we had up till very, very recently done such a fabulous job in Afghanistan, and we were doing a damn good job of what we were calling regenerating into a force able to do other things, many of which were from the sea base. So we were doing a lot of carrier embarked flying at about that time. I've got no qualms about the fact that the people who made those decisions did them for all the right reasons. We ran out of money, we had to save money, we had to retire an aircraft type, but it still feels like a bit of a kick in the teeth. And I think the proof of the pudding is that right now there are US Marine Corps Harriers deployed as hostilities rage in the east. Right now the Spanish have got their Harriers up working with the US Navy, and it's 12 years since we got rid of ours, so still a relevant platform. I'm going to read a short excerpt from my book, Harrier, How to Be a Fighter Pilot, that has recently been published, of which I'm very proud. And at the end, I set myself the quite considerable task of trying to work out what the best moment I did have whilst flying aeroplanes with the Royal Navy in the Joint Force and the US Navy was. And I came up with this at the very end. It's hard to be categorical about my best moment in the Royal Navy. However, time for first place is that moment in a dusty valley somewhere near Kalat in Afghanistan, when the firing had stopped and the ground forces could speak with normal tones and breathing rate, which meant that Simon and I had done our duty. Sharing's top spot is when I found out that I was a Sea Harrier pilot.